Hello, this is a football fans podcast and the people behind CelticUnderground.net. I'm Harry Brady, and thanks once again for listening and downloading to the Celtic Underground podcast. Some people might say my life is in a rut. I'm quite happy with what I got. People might say that I should strive for more, but I'm so happy I can see the fine things happening here. Fresh from one of the best performances of the season, certainly at Celtic Park, the first half showing against Hearts, we have a podcast that talks about that game and the January transfer window. Last few podcasts have obviously been about the Offensive Behaviour Act. We had John Mason, MSP, doing his bit, and we had Paul Quigley from FAC. So it's back on to the football, and who else but our man in South America, Mark Cooper, to give you an insight into watching the Rangers game on Brazilian TV, then the Celtic Hearts game, and an overview of how we think the club has performed in the January transfer window. So I will leave it there. You can listen to Mark's comments, insightful as always. And this is me, Harry Brady, with him, Mark Cooper. So I'm joined now by Mark Cooper. Mark, as we always do, what's the weather like in sunny South America?
It's hi to everyone. It's summertime here, so it's pretty hot. It's probably about 28-29 degrees, which instantly gives all the listeners a dislike of me.
Actually, you know, I often think in the middle of winter that in Scotland you forget how hot is.
There's also a thing that my friends and I here always say, that if we ever go back to Europe, why would you leave say Scotland or England or wherever in July, August, during the best time of year for weather? Instead, isn't it much more logical to go away in like January, February, when it's dire?
Yeah.
I know it's different with people with schools and whatever, but definitely, if I go back to Europe at some point, I'm definitely staying in Europe during the best summer, the best weather in the summer.
It makes sense. I mean, I remember being on holiday in Spain once and bumping into a British person who was in Spain, and they were talking about, for the expats in Spain, the bowling season runs from October till March, because so many expats go back home in April, May time, spend the summer in the UK and then go back again. They're basically there to avoid the crap weather.
Yeah.
So anybody who's been following you on Twitter will know you've been on a tour.
No, Instagram.
Sorry, Instagram.
So
Instagram's just Twitter with pictures.
It basically is. So basically the Argentinian and Uruguayan season, they finished, what, about Christmas time, a week before Christmas? Mm-hmm. And they've only, their leagues have only, well, in fact, the Uruguayan league starts this weekend and the Argentinian league started last weekend.
Right.
So they basically had about a five-week winter break, more or less, or summer break here. So New Year's and the first week of January, I had my summer holidays and I'm back now. In fact, I watched the Celtic Rangers game up in Brazil. And it was actually on Brazilian TV.
Right.
It was quite cool. Quite cool just listening to their pronunciation of Scottish names, which was quite amusing.
How'd you go on with your Brazilian Portuguese?
It's half decent.
Right.
It's so similar to Spanish.
But I always think it sounds like Spanish with a Russian accent.
Yeah. It sounds, especially Portuguese, like Portugal. Uh-huh. Portuguese in Portugal sounds almost Slavic, like when you hear Mourinho talk. The Brazilian one's a little bit more melodic and kind of maybe easier to understand a bit. but it's so similar to Spanish. Like, I stayed in Barcelona for about 4 or 5 months, and despite speaking Spanish, I couldn't understand any Catalan.
Right.
But I'd be in the supermarkets and they'd have their kind of announcements in Catalan, and I couldn't get a word. Whereas, like, Portuguese, without ever studying Portuguese, speaking Spanish, you can probably understand about 70-80% of it.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a comparison might be like Swedish and Norwegian or something like that.
So how did they, what did they think of the game?
I think the commentator was hyping it up at the start.
Mm-hmm.
And after about 20-25 minutes,
he felt like a ditty.
The adverts for the forthcoming game started coming on more and more, and even, I don't know if it was because they kind of turn the sound down of the crowd when they're showing games back in Europe, and the kind of South American commentators kind of much louder.
Mm-hmm.
But it seemed to me that the atmosphere was pretty tame.
I remember, it was so long ago. I think the atmosphere tailed off certainly in the second half as we were watching Celtic put in one of their worst performances of the season.
Yeah.
And so there was, I think, quite a bit of frustration. I think, you know, with Moussa Dembele playing like he was in his farewell testimonial and things like that, I think there was just a general bit of frustration because we'd not been playing well for a few weeks at that point, and then the second half in particular. So I think those two things together probably had an impact on it. Did you manage to pick up, so we're recording this on Thursday, did you manage to pick up Tuesday's game against Hearts?
Yeah. That's probably, that must be the best game in about 5-6 weeks.
Certainly from a home supporter perspective, it's probably one of the best home, certainly the first half, one of the best performances of the season at home.
Yeah.
What did you make of the system?
It was interesting. What I was kind of just about to say was that it seemed to me that just with the kind of presence of Musonda on the bench, that you kind of felt that we had so many different options. And that was also kind of slightly exacerbated with Kouassi playing as well.
Yep.
So it's like you kind of have two players going to midfield now, whereas Kouassi was always kind of, it's kind of on a bench, but it's always seemingly behind Armstrong and McGregor, and they didn't want to play the two defensive midfielders like Kouassi and Brown together. I thought Kouassi had a very good game. I thought Tierney was really sharp again.
Mm-hmm.
Thought he was excellent throughout. There's some very good crosses, and just kind of his whole play was pretty good.
I suppose he had more freedom because of the back three.
Yeah. And although Aya was almost playing as a right back,
mm-hmm.
he was so far to the right. And in fact, I've been watching all the games. There's something about Aya in the Partick Thistle game I noticed more was that Boyata was continually telling him to move further out. But Aya was, his positioning as we were kind of like building from the back,
mm-hmm.
he was almost in front of the goalkeeper.
Yeah.
Like slightly left of the goalkeeper, whereas Boyata was like on the corner of the box basically.
Mm-hmm.
And there must have been about 3 or 4 times where you see him kind of in the background, kind of, you know, like kind of gesturing to him to like pushing him on, like get on the other side of the box to receive the ball.
See, one of the things that struck me was, considering that Ayer 2-3 years ago was a centre midfielder, I would have thought Ayer would be better placed to be the middle of the three.
Uh-huh.
Because the middle of the three, you would think, would be more of the pivot and so more of a footballer. So it was interesting that he was on the right, and maybe it was to try and encourage him to play with a bit more width. The thing that struck me, not only that the system was slightly different, I think that might be the most Brendan Rodgers starters of any team that's uh-huh. been fielded. I mean, Dembele, Edouard,
the goalkeeper as well, De Vries.
Yeah, and Cham, Kouassi, De Vries. I'm trying to think. Was that
Simunovic? Oh, no, Simunovic was before, sorry.
Yeah, so those five were Brendan's, and then of course Masonda comes on as Brendan's, Sinclair comes on as Brendan's. So that's seven players that were used were Brendan players. And, well, Simunovic hardly featured under Dialer just simply because he wasn't fit, never fit. And Ayer never featured under Dialer, although he's obviously a Ronnie Dialer signing. So, so I thought that was interesting. What did you make of... because they were talking about him playing two up front, but I didn't really think it was two up front. Edwards was not playing as a striker to me.
I thought, as I forgot to say, Dembele, I thought, had a very good game.
Yeah.
And there was one moment, the moment I liked most of all was in the second half when he set Edward free.
Mm-hmm.
It was almost kind of like a replica of the goal that Edward scored, where Dembele puts a ball through and Edward's got like about 40 yards to run into. But the thing about the one in the second half was how quick the pass was.
Mm-hmm.
It comes into Dembele, he takes a touch and instantly he just like puts this ball, even before the defenders who are going to close him down, they've kind of like taken like a step towards Dembele to close him down, but the ball's already past them. And it was that kind of quickness and sharpness that you think that if that had happened against a European team, they wouldn't have been able to react to that either.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas sometimes you watch maybe a goal in Scotland and think, yeah, but if that was against, you know, a Europa League team, that player wouldn't have been over there and, you know, they would have been able to catch him or whatever. But that was a bit of genuine quality. And it kind of tailed off a little bit in the second half, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
But we were so dominant in the first, and we're already, what, three goals up or whatever?
I think that was the reason we'd won the game. I didn't know whether it was interestingly, Dembele came on against Hibs, and Dembele's substitution changed the game. Unfortunately, it changed it negatively, because the ball was just going up and bouncing off him. And it was interesting that Brendan has spent most of the January transfer window talking about not playing Dembele because Dembele's not going to be here. He expects him to leave and his mind's not with it. And in the last week, it's almost as if he's realised he's staying.
Yeah.
Changed his whole terminology about talking about Dembele, and that's changed Dembele. Or maybe Dembele realised he was staying and his mindset changed. I don't know.
Yeah. And we really need him for Zenit. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many games we've got left. It's about 2 weeks' time, right?
Yeah.
I think it's like a day or so.
Yeah, I think it's 2 weeks tonight as we record this.
Okay. And we really need him back sharp. And that was quite promising the other night, because it looked for the first time, possibly in the whole season, or at least the first time I can remember in the last 2 months, when I thought, oh, okay, that's kind of Dembele's level.
Yep.
He's getting back. But Edward, his hold up play, the ball kind of bounces off him a bit. And it's kind of unfortunate because he's only here for a year. Isn't like if we had signed Edward,
mm-hmm.
this would kind of be fine, because you're thinking, oh, we've got a promising player here. If he develops these parts of his game, you know, we might have a proper player in 2 years. But the fact that he's away in 4 months' time, like, you have to just focus on Dembele playing in the Europa League, and hopefully we'll get past Zenit. Hopefully we could have a run. We have to remember, Zenit haven't played a game since about November.
Yep.
The first game they play is against us. So imagine us playing...
Well, it's like our Champions League qualifiers.
Exactly.
Against Scandinavian teams.
Yeah, and you see how rusty we are, even playing like against the team from Gibraltar or whoever. That first game, getting into the last 20 minutes of the game at Parkhead, like... they're going to be tiring.
Yeah.
So I'm quietly confident about that. But yeah, and also, so Dembele is going to go this summer. So it'd be beneficial to us that he has a cracking last 4 months of the season.
Yeah.
Even if we're out of the Europa League, that he's banging in like 15 goals from now to the end, and he looks sharp, he looks fit, everyone's watching him, and then, you know, we get what he's worth.
Yeah, I mean, there's been a wee bit of criticism of how much Brendan has played Edward, and there's a part of me thought, yeah, but he's got to, because we've got 2 months, 3 months to decide whether we spend £7 million quid on him or not.
Yeah.
So he's got to play him. And frustratingly, probably, there's been glimpses of something that you think, as you've just said, there's been glimpses of things that you think, there's something here, patently wise at PSG, there's something here you can do with. But the obvious question is, would you spend £7 million quid on him to then make him our number one striker next season?
Is that a rhetorical question?
I'm asking you, as things stand right now.
No, definitely not.
You'd spend definitely. £1 million on him. Million and a half.
Yeah. But maybe slightly preempting another conversation we might have, but I think there's better value for, what, €7 million, €8 million? I think there's better value.
Well, before we get on to that, one of the things I do think that about Brendan's signing strategy, which we'll get onto in a second, that might have been evident on the Tuesday night, is I think Brendan's got something unique in. I know in the world scheme we're not a big club anymore in terms of finances, but in the grand scheme of.
I'm glad you added finances there.
Yes. No, but you know what I mean? We're in that Ajax, Benfica world of, we are a big club, but in the scheme of finances, we're not. But in the realms of big clubs, Brendan's in a very unique situation of, most clubs are now changing managers 12, 18 months. Yeah. And Brendan's sitting there with the ability to have a 5, 6, 7 transfer window planning process.
Yeah.
And so that's what the other thing that I thought was interesting about the number of Brendan signings in the team on Tuesday night, that Brendan might turn around and say, yeah, well, all I'm doing is planning over a rolling 2-3 year period. So Kouassi, I'm now starting to see as a first team player 12 months after being in. And Cham, 6 months after being in, I now see as a first team starter.
Yeah.
And the other thing that, you say Musonda might have given us a lift. I wondered if, and Brendan mentioned this, I only caught the very, very end of Radio Scotland of his interview after the game, was talking about Aya, Kouassi, Ncham, Dembele, Edouard, Tierney, we're all 21 and under.
Yeah.
Musonda came on at his age, obviously, and then mentioned the fact that Simonovic is only 23. So, I don't know whether that also... I think the crowd was lifted for Tuesday, having Musonda, as I was...
Yeah.
Although I was thinking about the fact that we were all getting very excited about a player that 99% of the people on the ground have probably never seen kick a ball, apart from a couple of clips on YouTube in the last 24 hours.
It was almost like the 90s, though. It was almost like getting a cadet or a Van Hooydonk. Yeah. You've never seen him, but you're ecstatic that we signed him.
Exactly. So that gave the crowd a lift. And I did wonder whether these younger people all gave the team a lift as well.
Yeah. And I thought, it might have been my imagination, but I thought the inclusion of Musonda there kind of maybe spurred the players on a bit, and maybe the fact that, you know, there's Kouassi there and he's starting to play well, and you're now getting, it's probably about 9 players for those 5 positions in midfield, and even someone like Sinclair, who was basically a nailed on starter at the start of the season, even for someone like him, the fact that Musonda, I think you could kind of play him anywhere across that line of three behind the striker. Then you get a lot of flexibility. Like, say Rodgers is playing really well in training. Maybe he wants to play Musonda behind one striker, say, for argument's sake. But Rodgers is looking incredible in training. He thinks, actually, I could just shift Musonda just over to the left.
Yeah.
Rodgers can play there. And then that spurs, you know, Sinclair then has to actually think, okay, I actually have to get on my game now. Mm-hmm. The same with Forrest. Roberts is coming back.
Yep.
You have McGregor, Armstrong, and Cham, Brown, Kouassi. There's a lot of players. I think, what, 9-10 players there for five positions?
I mean,
Go on.
You mentioned a player there that I think has summed up our November, December, beginning of January time. I like McGregor. I think McGregor playing for Hibs would be a star man for Hibs. And I think McGregor deserves to be in the Scotland squad. But I'm not sure about McGregor as a nailed on starting every game for Celtic quality of player. And I think the fact that he has been starting every game for Celtic in the number 10 position as well has shown what part of our problem has been in the last 2-3 months in terms of creativity and the quality of what we've got.
I think you're completely right. But also, I think you have to remember that McGregor's been playing since July. Like, McGregor's playing, what is it, Rosenberg this year we had? And all of these players, they're continually playing. So the fact that, like, I'm maybe not McGregor's, like, biggest fan, but I think I'd even recognise that, like, the level he's been playing at in the last month or so isn't his, you know, top level. If McGregor's playing at his top level, as hopefully he will be when this competition, then I think that's a genuine competition to get in. Like, I don't think that, you know, it's so automatic that someone just takes his place. Because I think that McGregor, on the top of his game, is a pretty good player. I think under pressure in limited spaces, when you give him the ball, he rarely loses it. Maybe he's not the most creative player ever, and maybe he fails to maybe impose himself on a game at times, but I still think he's a pretty decent player still.
So then we'll move on to the January transfer window. So Brendan talked about a revolving door, and actually before I came on the podcast, my boy's got a picture on his wall of last season's squad. There's 30 players in it, 12 of whom are no longer at Celtic Park, and there's other fringe players who've moved out. So how do you see the January transfer window?
Okay, so just going through the players. So Hendry, I think I'm actually a bit more positive about than possibly most people. The fact that, can you remember a game against Dundee in October? When Dundee actually played quite well against us.
Was that the one at Celtic Park? Was it?
Yeah.
And De Vries was in goals for that game and had two saves that...
Is that right?
Yeah, two saves that... we won it 1-0 and he had two great saves towards the end of the game.
Okay. So, the guy in midfield, Kamara, had a pretty good game. O'Hara had a decent game. But the best was Hendry. And there was a moment in the first half where Sinclair's got a ball on the left-hand side. Hendry is kind of playing on the right of defence. Maybe they're playing a back three and he's a kind of right-sided one of that or something.
I think they were playing a three, yeah.
Against Sinclair in two moments. And basically, as Sinclair always does, he pushes the ball past the defender. And he normally gets it, kind of like, knocked it, say, 15 yards, 10 yards, whatever, and goes. And twice in a row within about 5 minutes. Hendry turns quickly, accelerates, and beats Sinclair to the ball twice. And I remember, I was watching in my flat here in Buenos Aires, and I remember on Twitter going, who's that defender? and there's people in the stadium, the guy Patrick Maguire,
the photographer.
He goes, I saw that as well, or something to that extent. And then there's about three of us having a conversation about this young boy Hendry, and we're like trying to find out how old he is and whatever. And right after that game, Rogers made a point of saying that although like Scotland might have a crisis in centre backs, I think you've got a promising one there, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So he's quick, he's very good on a turn. He's what, about 6'2", 6'3", something
yeah,
like that.
So, yeah.
Good physique. I haven't seen him enough to. I've seen him like twice against us this season, so I don't know. It's just a plane going over it.
I just wondered if there was another coup happening in Argentina.
There's another coup. They're taking the Malvinas back. So I haven't seen enough of him to know, you know, like his distribution from the back, or how he is in cross balls, or you know how he is, you know, positionally. Whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But he definitely does have some kind of natural ability, like obvious kind of natural abilities there. Like turning, especially if we're playing a high line,
yep.
Maybe trying to force a play in Europe,
mm-hmm.
Having a guy that quick and that good in the turn is promising. I could see him overtaking Ayer from now to the end of the season.
Do you think so?
Yeah. Yeah. Who else? There's
so
Bain.
if we go Bain backwards from the end of the window, so Bain the goalkeeper. Yeah.
Bain the goalkeeper, I'm not that keen on, to be honest. I think we've seen him because he's kind of been linked to us for about 2 years or so,
mm-hmm.
And he's kind of been a fairly prominent player because he's been in a couple of Scotland squads. He's got quite quick reactions, but he makes some glaring errors, to be honest. And it's slightly harsh considering he hasn't played for us. But if I'm giving my opinion on, you know, I don't think he's European class. And although he might be a short-term backup keeper, I think goalkeeper is possibly a position we could upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
And with the unfortunate injury to Gordon, I thought we might have kind of fast-forwarded that kind of process up and maybe gone for someone who we were hoping to get for next season. So, slightly disappointing, slightly odd that now.
But then, if we
seems as though we wouldn't do that because we could have done it now.
If we want Conor Hazard to be the goalkeeper, which everything I'm hearing we do, so that's why he went to Falkirk, because we think he needs 12 months of first team football.
Yeah.
So I suppose the dilemma is, based on the point I was making about Brendan being in a unique position to plan 2-3 years down the line that other managers can't, if Brendan's thinking, right, 2 years' time, Conor Hazard should be looking to be our first choice goalkeeper.
Yeah,
you can see why he's quite happy to stick with two mid to late 30-year-old goalkeepers who are experienced, know the way around first team football. Might not be the greatest, but they're not the worst. You can see why Brendan's been happy to stick with Gordon and De Vries, because he's thinking they'll do me for the next 2 years till Conor Hazard comes through. And maybe his whole dilemma is, if I go and sign somebody, I've just blown Conor Hazard out the window.
Possibly. That's quite long term, though. You're talking 2 years, in which time you could buy. So you're basically saying that I would say that we should be upgrading Gordon for next season.
Mm-hmm.
And even if we had a wonder kid goalkeeper who they thought was going to be European class within 24 months, that in that time period we should still have an upgrade.
Well, maybe they have identified somebody, and they think they can get him in the summer. You never know.
Possibly, yeah.
You know, the fact that they only... I tell you what, I was surprised at. Bain's 6 foot.
Yeah.
And Brendan, having been in the Premiership, I remember hearing an agent on Radio Scotland talking about the fact that... I can't remember which keeper it was. Whoever it was, there was some foreign keeper who was playing in Scotland that they really rated. This is a few years ago. And Wigan were in the... I think Paul Jewell was the Wigan manager or something. And they'd gone to Paul Jewell, and Paul Jewell, before he'd asked anything else, his first question was, what height is he? And the agent was saying that they will not look at a goalkeeper at 6'3" or below in England, because that's just, you need someone who's big stature.
Yeah.
And so I was quite surprised then, that, because I think Brendan, from a few things Brendan said, I think Brendan might buy into that concept as well. So I was quite surprised he would go for a 6 foot goalkeeper.
Yeah. I don't want to be overly critical about a guy, you know. He's never played for us, but I'm surprised we went for him.
Having said that, Brendan's argument might be, I've not been scouting for a goalkeeper. I've identified the guy I want. He'll be available in the summer. I'm just putting devil's advocate.
Aye.
So I had 36, 48 hours to find a goalkeeper.
Mm-hmm.
I needed to give it, and so could, I know what he can deliver. He's only going to be second choice. He'll, you know.
Yep.
I had limited options.
Morgan, I don't really know anything about it because I don't watch Championship over here. And Musonda, funnily enough, actually, about 2.5 years ago, I was back home at my parents' place, just west of London, for about a fortnight or so. And Chelsea's development team played ours in Aldershot when I was back. I had no idea where Aldershot was. It's one of these places like Nuneaton or Basingstoke where you're not actually sure.
Everybody's heard of it, but if you were to put it in on the map, you'd be within 100 miles.
And I've driven there and I'm still not exactly sure where it is. So I drove over there and watched the game, and Chelsea beat us 5-0.
Mm-hmm.
And it was pretty embarrassing. And there were two players in the Celtic team who could cope. There was Aidan Nesbitt, and Mikey Johnston came on in the last 20 minutes.
Obviously,
and they were the only two players. Yeah. But they were the only two players who could hold the ball under pressure.
Uh-huh.
And who did Chelsea have? Musonda was captain, and he was superb. And they had the boy who's now at Swansea, the tall boy, Tammy Abraham, who played, and maybe one or two others who are vaguely kind of known. But Musonda was sensational. He was really good. And he was basically just running a show.
I'm looking to see if I can find someone I know who sent me a message about... So I got this message from the person who will know who he is. He's saying, Chelsea supporting mate just sent me this on Musonda. He's a bit of a maverick talent, but his ability is next level. Chelsea fans that are into all the youth football stuff are fuming he's not getting a game, let alone being sent out on loan. He was a lot smaller than I was expecting, though. You've not seen anything. In any pictures you've seen, are like a close-up with no context of his size. He's about the same size as Patrick Roberts.
Is that right?
Aye, he was really, really... I think it was more evident because we had the 6 foot one, 6 foot two Kouassi, the 6 foot in Cham, the 6 foot two Dembele, the 6 foot Edouard, the 6 foot five Ayer, the 6 foot three Simonovic and Boyata. I think it was the fact that we had such a big team that compounded how small he looked when he came on.
He's very slight as well, isn't he?
He is, yeah.
Yeah.
Lewis Morgan, I'm like you, I don't really know anything. I do know that the day that we were supposed to be signing, we got a text from a mate saying, I'm watching this Midden game, don't really think much of Lewis Morgan. As that text arrived, goal St Mirren, Lewis Morgan. 2 minutes later, goal St Mirren, Lewis Morgan.
Sorry.
Yeah, so. Well, I mean, he's obviously had a reasonable start in his football career, having gone through the Rangers system, which, you know, much as we can slag it off, it's the second best system in Scottish football, so.
Yeah, although the guy in charge of it doesn't seem to be able to spot any talent.
Yes.
He lets Lewis Morgan go. He also, but he ditched Harry Cochran as well.
Yep.
What is he thinking?
So there was Lewis Morgan and then Mavrin Compere.
Ah, yeah. Well, I think we spoke about this in about. It was after one of the Champions League games when we were talking about it would be good having a more experienced defender.
Mm-hmm.
To be honest, if I'm honest, I was kind of thinking of a Mark Reaper, you know, 28, 29,
yep.
And he'd have 3 years in his prime or whatever, rather than a guy who's 32, about to be 33. But then again, if you buy Compere when he's 28, 29, he's going to cost, what, €5 million yep. or whatever. So,
I mean, your point about Ayer and obviously his having signed Hendry, I'm just looking at that thinking, we've signed a guy at 32 to help Hendry and Ayer become better centre-halves. Your point about Boyata telling Ayer where to go.
Yeah.
We've signed a guy who speaks better English than half the SPFL native players. To talk young players through how to be a centre half, who's been there, done that, and played 350 Bundesliga games.
Yeah.
So, overall,
one other thing is that I also thought we could. I was kind of hoping we might try and upgrade the right back position as well,
mm-hmm.
and in particular because Lustig's going to be away at World Cup.
Yep. And Gamboa.
And Gamboa, and our biggest games are happening around then, basically.
Well, they're having them in Scotland, they're on tour in South America or whatever it is.
I think I'll give that a miss.
You're not going to go to the Scotland games?
I'll give that a miss.
Do you know, I do know that...
If Mikey Johnson gets a call-up...
Well, I doubt it, because I know that...
Celtic, he was injured, wasn't he?
There was many people in Celtic who were not disappointed when Scotland didn't qualify for the World Cup, because we would have had 7-8 players at the World Cup and Champions League qualifiers. So that's why Celtic are so pissed off with this South American tour. So one of the things that strikes me about our January transfer dealings, there's no particularly great evidence of the Lee Congerton effect. In terms of a wider look, and again, one of the challenges that we've got is we find Virgil van Dijk, but even in the 4 years since we found Virgil van Dijk, if you look at the books of Chelsea and Man City and Man United and Liverpool and Spurs and PSG, any player across Europe who's half talented from 16 up seems to be going to these clubs.
Yeah.
So our ability to go for to find a Virgil van Dijk bargain is rapidly diminishing. And I do know that Brendan's a bit frustrated that £3-4 million players like Ncham and Kouassi are on a par with what we've already got, but maybe after a year of being around Celtic, they'll start to be the first team players, but they're not immediately come in and make the squad better. That we need to, that if you're shopping in Europe, you're like £7-8 million to find that type of player, which we can afford the £7-8 million, but we can't afford the £80,000-£90,000 wages that go with a £7-8 million player. So he's getting a bit frustrated at that. which naturally then leads to why should we not be looking further afield?
Yeah, well, I think anyone who regularly listens to me on a podcast will will know my response to that. But also quite often I also say, I think it is an oversight not to look at South America, obviously.
Yeah.
I also think we should be also concentrating. The thing is, obviously, there's places and regions that consistently produce players.
Mm-hmm.
And the prices of the elite players that are produced from there leave at a level or price that Celtic can still afford,
mm-hmm.
in a way that, I think I've said this as well on the podcast, that if there's an elite player in France, Germany, Spain, Italy, England, we can't get them.
Yep.
99 times out of 100, we cannot get the elite kid who grows up in Manchester, Birmingham, or Munich, or Rome.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, where can you get the elite kid? And where continually produces over, you know, decades and still have the same kind of economic conditions, that means that they're still going to be doing it. Well, to me, it's quite obvious. To me, around Brazil, you might not be able to afford them either, because mm-hmm. their local kind of footballing economy has grown with TV rights and whatever, that the kid who grows up and is a star at Flamengo, Real Madrid buy him for €40 million.
Mm-hmm.
Or the guy at Grêmio, Arthur, he's going to head off to an elite club for, you know, like 30 or so. So even there. But Uruguay, Colombia, Chile, Argentina, yeah. And they continually produce. In Europe, the Balkan countries,
mm-hmm.
they continually produce and we can afford them. Now, the second part of that is that every major club, and even non-major club, basically any medium-sized and above club in Europe has a scouting program, Instat or Y-Scout, whatever. And basically, for the listeners, that's a program that the clubs pay for, and they get the footage of every league game around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can click on the kid in Dynamo Zagreb's left back and see how he got on in the last, every time he crosses a ball in the last year.
Mm-hmm.
Celtic are able to see the guy from Slovan Bratislava, Dynamo Zagreb, whatever. But every club can do that.
Yep.
So when an 18-year-old makes his debut for Dynamo Zagreb, basically any serious club around Europe is watching that game, is watching that kid's performance in that game.
Mm-hmm.
Probably including us. So then you have a problem that we have no competitive advantage over Nice, Rennes, whatever. So then how does Celtic get a competitive advantage? Even looking at Argentina or Croatia or whatever, how do we get the competitive advantage? And it's about early identification of the player.
Mm-hmm.
So for Celtic to beat Inter Milan or whatever to the next Modric,
mm-hmm.
we have to have a guy, in my opinion, if we're serious about it, we have to have a guy who we pay to stay in Croatia. He can maybe cover Serbian Croatia.
Mm-hmm.
And he has to go around watching Dynamo Zagreb, Hajduk Split, under 18, 17, 16, 15s, the same in Serbia, and that's his job. And then when the next Modric appears, or whoever, we're going to identify them before the big clubs. which is why Udinese get Alexis Sanchez before even the Chilean clubs got Alexis Sanchez. Because Udinese have people in Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, whatever. And they make a ton of money doing it. So they get Alexis Sanchez, 17, loan him to the big club in Chile, Colo-Colo, then loan him to River Plate, then after 2 years, when he's kind of, they think, okay, now he's ready. They bring him over, 2 years in Serie A, sell him for 30-odd million to Barcelona. And there's so many different, like, I remember writing articles about this for the site, about 5-6 years ago. Yeah, the serious clubs do this. So 4 years ago, I was in contact with a club in the UK. And I wrote to them about a player who hadn't yet made his debut in Colombia. And I said, you should be watching this player. 3 years later, now he wasn't on a pro contract. So it was training compensation. And I said to his club in Britain, you should look at him. 3 years later, he goes to Ajax. A year after that, 12 months, Ajax make a 35 million euro profit on him. To employ someone in Croatia, you know, Romania, whatever, it's going to be so much worth. It's definitely the benefit. It's so much higher than the cost of one person's wage in Croatia.
Yes, if you got one person, even if other ancillary costs, you got them on 30 grand, which in Croatia would be a very big wage, right? So I'm picking 30 grand just to be at the top end. Even if your ancillary costs of having that guy at 30 grand pushes his total cost to 100 grand a year.
But not even.
No, I was going to say, but even if you did that... So that's £1 million every 10 years. Even if you only found you one player in that 10-year period.
Yep.
If you make more than £1 million profit, he's paid for himself.
Yep. So, yeah, I was looking at a boy. For the last 2 years, I've been watching a boy in Uruguay who in 2 years, he was a 14-year-old. And for 2 years, he scored... approximately 130 goals. And I compiled a report, blah, blah, blah. Sent it off. So he made his debut sometime in October, I think. And he comes on in a Premier League game in Uruguay. And he scores twice in 10 minutes. And the week after, the Italian papers are saying that the Juventus and Inter Milan, if I remember correctly, are sending scouts to this kid's next game. Really? If you're quick enough, if you have someone in that area, you can beat them. They're doing it because they're on Y-Scout.
Yeah.
Like, we're on Y-Scout. Like, every club in Europe's on Y-Scout. And they've seen, hey, look, a 16-year-old's just scored twice in Uruguay. Let's go. And presumably, they've been over. So you need to beat them. If Uruguay and Argentina, for example, have been producing players... The best, well, Argentina definitely, the best players in the world for 100 years. And there are the same economic conditions here. And in some cases, the same coaches that are producing these players and the same scouts that are getting these players. And they're continually producing players. At some point, the next Icardi is coming out here. The next Messi is coming out, the next whoever. The next Suarez is coming out in Uruguay. And it's going to be one of these kids.
Yeah.
And even if it isn't the next Suarez, it still might be a level of, you know, a good quality Serie A or La Liga striker like Uruguay have been producing for the last decade. who, you know, like, who get to a level of a Betis or Real Sociedad or whatever. There's a player for the same club, actually, as the young kid was playing for, called Maxi Gomez.
Mm-hmm.
And this gives you an indication of the profitability of it. So he's a kind of John Hartson type player, kind of slightly overweight, not much movement, kind of good battling against the defender and using his body to back in and strike a goal. And this team defensor sold him for, I think it was $3 million. This, and that was in July, August.
Mm-hmm.
This transfer window, a Chinese club, and this is a legitimate, a Chinese club put in a $20 million bid for him,
mate,
in a 6-month period. There's a lot of... like, you can go through half of the Uruguay squad. Like, Godin, who in my opinion, Diego Godin's been the best defender of the last decade or whatever. I think he's been great. Atletico Madrid captain.
Mm-hmm.
He left for 600,000. His partner, Jimenez, young guy who left, 3 years ago? He left for $1 million. Godin, if he leaves now, he's a 60, 70 million pound player. Jimenez is going to be about the same. The boy, the Colombian before, who I mentioned before, if he leaves Tottenham now, he's going to be possibly in the top three of the most expensive centre-backs. They spent 40 million on him, and he's been playing well and consistently, and he's about 22. There's a lot of profit. Even apart from the kind of sporting benefit,
mm-hmm.
there's the economic benefit.
I mean, if it was me, well, the economic benefit, you just look at, I wish I could remember the figure, but I remember reading something about how much profit Chelsea have made in the last 2 years from selling the guys who never made the Chelsea first team. And it was something like 130 million quid or whatever. But if it was me, obviously, this is the type of thing we use for the likes of Dembele and Van Dijk and Wanyama, this type of argument. But for me, this is the same argument you take to South America. Even more so now would be, you're a talented young player and you want to play at the top level of European football. You can go at 17, 18 to Man City, Chelsea, and they will take you into their system and then look to start farming you out. And then eventually you'll go to loan to this club, loan to that club, all across Europe. You'll never really feel at home in the continent. And you'll permanently be getting loaned out to clubs below the standard of Chelsea and Man City. You'll never get to them. However, see, if you come to Celtic, you'll play first team football at Champions League level, and you will be seen by these top clubs. And that's why we've had Fraser Foster leave us to become an England squad goalkeeper. You've had Virgil van Dijk leave us and become the highest, the most expensive centre defender in British football. Victor Wanyama leave us and go and play.
Yeah.
You can start to use those. And obviously, if Dembele goes in the summer to wherever he goes, that would be my big USP to those players.
And specifically for South America, you can highlight the fact that Brendan Rodgers has developed Suarez and Coutinho to be amongst the top, Suarez is possibly the best striker in the world as a proper number nine. And Coutinho, how much was he? 150 million? 140 million?
Yeah.
And they're both at Barcelona.
Mm-hmm.
But any kid growing up in Buenos Aires or Montevideo or whoever, that's the aim. The aim is to get to Barcelona.
Now, obviously, one of the famous but can they get a work permit things. So you've said on this podcast before, something like 75% of people playing in the top two tiers of Argentinian and Uruguayan football have got European passports. Is that right?
Yeah, it's For Argentinians in Europe, in the top five leagues in Europe, it's 80. And for Uruguayans, I think it's 68%. I mean, I think about this time last year, more or less, I was chatting to you about going up to the area, the region called Santa Fe, that includes Rosario.
Mm-hmm.
And up there, they produce loads of players. Like Messi's from there, Di Maria, Mascherano, Batistuta, blah, blah, blah. And Newell's old boys are from there in Rosario. They have a famous guy called Jorge Grifa,
mm-hmm.
who's like, he's a good player, and then he became this like famous scout for discovering half of these players. He worked for Newell's and then Boca and then Independiente. And this is about 14 months ago. I went up, he started up his own academy,
mm-hmm.
that then he basically sells to the clubs.
Right.
And about 14 months I went up there and I was saying to you, and there's this guy called one of the more famous players who's just left there when I was up there. It's called Lo Celso, who's gone to Paris Saint-Germain.
Mm-hmm.
He was a guy who crossed in for Cavani when Cavani scored the header against us.
Yep.
Came on in the second game as well. And when I was talking to you in the podcast about a year ago, I said, and there's another guy who's going to be the star of Independiente. And Atlanta just bought him for $15 million. Which then shows you, and in fact, the reason I thought of that was because I asked them that specific question about, okay, but it's going to be difficult for us because I work for a scouting company, so mm-hmm. if I'm representing a club in the UK, I've got a team in the Premiership, and they're asking about the inevitable question, as you brought up, what about passports?
Mm-hmm.
And they said, they estimated that 80% of the boys who are training with them from, say, 15 to 18 already have European passports, that they try and get that sorted.
Right.
Because that obviously provides a higher value. So, yeah, that's an indication. Now, the other thing about this kid who's gone for 15 million, Barco,
mm-hmm.
is that Atlanta now, they've got the old Argentina boss, who was also the Barcelona boss, Martino.
Mm-hmm.
And the MLS are now sweeping up the Argentinian kids.
Right.
They're now competing with Udinese, Porto, Benfica, Ajax. And they're now in it as well. So it's given a kind of interesting dimension to it. But what they don't offer, and what no club offers, is the proximity and the exposure to the EPL.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the main drawbacks, maybe the kid who you're talking about, hypothetically, would still want to go to Chelsea or Man City or whatever, Liverpool.
Yep.
What you can say to them is, say he goes to Chelsea and he's going to be farmed out to Vitesse Arnhem or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
We can say to him, you come to Celtic, and one of their qualms about a player is that you're not culturally adapted. You don't speak any English,
mm-hmm.
and you haven't lived in Britain, and you're not used to our weather. So,
the famous can you do it on a wet Wednesday in Stoke concept?
Yeah, completely. And you put them in Glasgow and they learn English over 2 years,
mm-hmm.
and they're in worse conditions than are in the climatic conditions than in England.
Yep.
And then you've got rid of two of those problems that an EPL club might have,
mm-hmm.
about signing a Latin American footballer, because they've proven it and now they speak English, and it's perfect then to go into the EPL. If you go to Benfica, if you go to Porto, if you go to Ajax, they're still going to have that qualm.
Mm-hmm. How do you fly from Glasgow to Argentina? I'm not suggesting I do it. I'm just thinking about
very expensively.
Yeah, do you have to go?
Yeah.
Glasgow to London, London to Lisbon, Lisbon across, that type of thing?
Well, you'd have London to Argentina, direct flight.
You can go direct, right?
Yeah. Sometimes there's a stop in Madrid or Paris, but you can get direct flights to Argentina and Montevideo.
I just... The world is a small place these days. And I can't get my head around us just... You know, we've proved that we're, you know, in Kwasi.
Yeah.
The sort of Northern European grounds that we were buying were becoming saturated with, and we went to Russia to buy a boy from Africa. So that was 12 months ago that we illustrated that.
The good thing though about Congerton is that he spotted Coutinho. The good thing about Brendan Rodgers is that he's developed Coutinho and also Suarez. So they're obviously, they themselves, that would kind of imply, are pretty open to doing it. For me, the thing is the area identification. You have to beat the other clubs. And it's difficult to do that. It's not impossible. You can still scout them and find a high quality player using Y Scout and whatever. But it's much more beneficial to, when they play those first five games or whatever, there's another player. There's a player at Banfield just now, a small club in the south of Buenos Aires, who's very good. And he's played, I think, five games. The good thing is, though, is that if you've seen him in reserves for the past 2 years, you already know his quality, and you know his limitations, and you already have a scouting report ready for when he explodes, as opposed to Porto, or whoever. Porto isn't a good example because they have people down here, but another club like Lyon or whatever, who have just waited until Y-Scout.
See, if it was me, and particularly just now with their club being reasonably cash rich in terms of where we normally are, I would be looking at it thinking, right, okay, how do we get the Masonda standard of player as a player that we can make money out of? Do you know what, I'm not just, maybe you might trial it, but I would be inclined to say, right, okay, let's have a South American strategy. I'm not going to bring one guy across here who's on his own, feels completely homesick. I'm going to try over an 18-month, two-year window to bring a few across, and we're going to have some infrastructure back here. So we're going to have people over there to be in there early, as you identify, and I'm going to have an infrastructure back here that allows young kids to assimilate here. So I'm going to make sure that we're bringing over more than one or two, and so obviously you have to kiss a few frogs. If we're going to bring over four or five over an 18-month window, we've got a greater chance of a failure amongst those four or five, because that's what I'm doing. But equally, we've got a greater chance of a success, because we've got more numbers over. And I'm going to make sure that they've got the right accommodation, and I'm going to have a 24-hour interpreter who's not just a Spanish interpreter from Spain, it's actually a Spanish interpreter from South America, so his understanding of the culture and the dialect that they're coming from. And I wouldn't just play at it, I would have a proper strategy for doing that. And it might just be, right, we'll trial for 18 months and see if this works. We're going to invest more heavily and we'll have more guys over there. That seems straightforward to me.
I agree, and I think that's an advantage, or kind of a progression, that the EPL clubs have had in the last, say, 10 years. That obviously London's now a kind of much more multicultural.
Yes,
and
an international city is, yeah.
Yeah, and you now get kind of a Colombian community with, say, five bars and a few restaurants, so like a Colombian player would kind of... But the clubs themselves also have improved that, I think.
Yeah.
One other last thing about this is that by having people... If you have people on the ground as opposed to only scouting by Y-Scout, and you have someone who's living there and reading the newspapers, talking to the clubs, talking to the agents,
mm-hmm.
they then get extra information that you're not getting on Y-Scout.
Yeah.
So I know that the best centre-back in Argentina has a release clause of €3.5 million.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get that on Y-Scout.
You also might get, if there's a guy in the ground... You also may get, unfortunately, that guy's from an utterly bonkers family.
Yeah, completely.
So he might not sell.
Yep.
Yeah. What, one of the best players in Argentina, you wouldn't touch at all. Technically, he's brilliant, but you wouldn't want to go near him.
So, yeah, you're completely right. Yeah. And that sometimes, you know, clubs make these mistakes. They bring over, and within about a week or a month, you start hearing whispers about a player, and they're like trying to get the boy.
A guy where they send a taxi and he has to get breathalyzed every morning. The taxi driver will phone ahead and tell the team who wear a blue strip and white shorts, black socks, red tops that their Mexican guy will be too steaming for training that day. That type of feedback.
Possibly, yeah.
But what you have to consider is apparently he marks Scott Brown out of the game.
So yeah, but you get the type of feedback of he's already starting to get a drink problem.
Yeah. And even just culturally as well, that some people might adapt better than others.
Mm-hmm.
There's a Chilean boy who I was looking at, pretty good player, pretty talented player, and he is already fluent in English. And then I was kind of looking into his background, and you got the impression that by kind of looking at his posts on social media and whatever, that he would be very comfortable living in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Just a kind of person that he was coming across as. Anyway,
all very frustrating, and we'd like to see it. I just think the challenge is obviously the English market is that we are right next to is far too expensive for us to be shopping in on a regular basis, and the Northern European market where, you know, we've picked up Van Dijk and we picked up Wanyama is also starting to be too expensive for us, so it's natural that we should be looking further afield than that. And as you say, the Balkans and then South America are the two obvious places that there's still scope, and you could get in there early, and if you get in there early enough, you might then become a Benfica type team that a fan of, you know, the Ajax Underground podcast in 4 years' time, we're saying the problem is Celtic are already in there and Celtic have already bought that guy and sold him on for £50 million profit. And the difficulty is there's a track record. We've got to get in there, and people already see Celtic as the route to get down that route.
Yeah, because the route is to get to England.
Yeah.
And we're uniquely placed for it. One other thing is that by selling it,
you then, Celtic, the only way we are going to properly compete in Europe is if we raise our capital.
Uh-huh.
And without TV money or big sponsorship money that we haven't had for 2 decades now, the only other way is, well, we get a good chunk from UEFA if we qualify.
And the other way, the way that Porto have been able over the last 15 to 20 years of being able to compete at a pretty good level, is by their resale.
Yeah.
So it's inevitable. If we are going to maximise our potential, you have to look in the best resale markets to be, you know, selling to the Tottenham for the 35 million, 40 million euro.
Well, and then it becomes that player of, if we start to, on a semi-regular basis, finish second or third in Champions League group stages, and when we finish third, win two or three rounds of the Europa League, when we finish second, hold our own at least,
yeah,
in the Champions League games, that's when you do then start to sell the odd player for 30 to 50 million pounds.
Yeah.
And the transformation of every three, four years, or even two, yeah, 3 years, selling a guy at 30, 40 million pound profit.
Yeah.
So, you know, the massive transformation of that. You could have heaters in the main stand.
And can I get aircon here?
Exactly. So we've got Kilmarnock on Saturday. How do you see that going?
3-0 Kilmarnock. Boytastic.
Be interesting to see if Musonda starts.
Yeah.
Because we're obviously, how many games have we got before Zenit? What, 2-3?
We've so, Kilmarnock on Saturday, then we must be, Kilmarnock Saturday, we must be playing some in midweek. No, we're not playing some in midweek this week. We've then got Thistle in the Cup the following Saturday, and then we get Zenit Thursday.
Okay. So we've got two games, so it'll be interesting to see the lineup, because obviously we're going to be like gearing up for this game.
Yep.
I would assume we'll kind of get an indication of what the Zenit team's going to be.
Yeah, because I think he'll play. Yeah, I think he'll be looking at playing our strongest team.
Yeah.
So, your prediction for the score. Is Musonda going to score in his first start?
Where is it? It's Kilmarnock. It doesn't even matter. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Be good, especially with Dembele. I'd like Dembele to get a couple of goals.
I thought Dembele was playing better against Hearts on Tuesday, and then his game improved even more once he put the ball in the back of the net. The problem against Hibs when he came on was the ball was just bouncing off him.
Yeah.
And anytime he did actually take the ball and then try, he would take the ball and try and beat someone, all he was doing was just turning and running into a Hibs player. Against Hearts, suddenly he was bringing the ball in, playing it off. Could have obviously been better support and things like that, but he started to be as you said at the beginning, the Dembele we expect.
Yeah.
Right, well, I hope that is the case. And with that, Mark Cooper, I'll say thanks very much.
Cheers.
Bring me sunshine in your smile.
I hope you enjoyed that podcast with Mark. Give you a bit more insight in some of the stuff you'll be aware of, and some of the stuff you might not be aware of what he's doing down there in South America, and some of the very interesting about some of the players that he's passed on to some British-based clubs. Anyway, enough of me. There's plenty of Celtic FC Foundation stuff going on. There is the Walk on Fire that you can do. It's not for me because I'm a shitebag, but if you fancy walking on hot coals at Celtic Park, famously Martin O'Neill would have walked across broken glass to get to Celtic Park job, and Brendan Rodgers would have done similar. I think you still get enough time to register for the 23rd of February for the firewalk at Celtic Park. There is also the Boy on the Road, who's going to every single away game this season and raising money for the Celtic FC Foundation. You can find him on Twitter, or if you go to away games, you'll be able to find him and you can donate there. There's plenty of other foundation events. Go to the Celtic FC Foundation's website and you'll find out about things like the forthcoming golf day again, which we'll revisit in the spring, and the Celtic skydive. And of course, if you're just doing anything a fun run, a 10k, a half marathon, a full marathon, you're a fitter man than me, and also you can you have the Celtic FC Foundation as your chosen charity. Just get in touch. Anyway, enough of me. Hope you enjoyed the podcast. This is me, Harry Brady, saying thanks everyone for all the reviews you leave on iTunes, the comments lots of you leave on YouTube, and for downloading and listening, and speak to you again soon. That was me with Mark Cooper. Good night and God bless. Good night.
Up above, bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love. Bring me sunshine in your smile. Bring me laughter all the while. In this world where we live, there should be more happiness. So much joy you can give to each brand new bright tomorrow. Make me happy through the years. Never bring me any tears. Let your arms be as warm as the sun from up above. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love, sweet love. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me